Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Woods Murder by Roy Lewis, narrated by Chris MacDonnell. Chapter 1. Most women were fascinated by Charles Lendon. It might have been his sharp good looks, it might have been his domineering manner, it was possibly his presence. He had a way of drawing attention to himself without effort in a crowded room. Cathy Tennant liked him, but was not fascinated by him. There had been occasions when Lendon had stood close to her, almost touching her. There had been occasions when he brushed against her arm unnecessarily, held her hand over long, looked at her in a way that principals did not or should not look at young articled clerks. There had been occasions when she had caught a glimpse of something in his eyes that she had been unable to understand. A longing, perhaps? She had put it down to many things, to his practiced gallantry, to his way with women, to her youth and his age. But she liked him nevertheless, for he was sharp and intelligent, and he looked after her professionally. He made her work. It was what he did on that Friday morning. He came through into her room and smiled. "Cathy, I've got something for you." His voice was deep, with a practiced timbre. She sometimes felt that there was something theatrical about Charles Lendon, as though he were always aware of an audience, a female audience. As he smiled, his scarred eyebrow lifted sardonically. "Nice problem for you. Chap called Quarter. We'll be getting counsel's opinion, but it'll do you good to have a crack at it first. Let me have your notes on it, and after we've taken counsel's opinion, we can check one against the other. You've finished the Stevenson conveyance, haven't you?"
"Well, I'm afraid not, Mr. Lendon. There's been some difficulty concerning the right of way across—"
"Hell, don't talk to me of rights of way. I've had too much trouble over the Kenton Wood affair to do other than flinch whenever I hear the words."
He smiled again, taking the bite from the words. It was an easy, attractive smile. He'd kept his teeth in good shape. "Anyway, when you can, Cathy. I'm out for a while now, but bring the papers into me about 3, all right?" He touched her lightly on the shoulder before he took his leave. She turned to the papers curiously. The details were all there. Charles Lendon's notes made it clear. Quarter claimed to have been told by the dealer who had supplied the van that certain major repairs had been carried out to the vehicle, but within 3 days of taking the van, Quarter realized the repairs had not been completed.
"Mr. Lendon gone out?"
Maxwell, one of the young assistant solicitors, stuck his owlish head around the door with the query.
"Yes, he won't be back until lunchtime."
"Look, Cathy, I've got a couple of clients that I have to interview this morning, and Parnell's equally cluttered up. So do you think you could let me have this room this morning?"
"Of course, Max. I'll go along to the library. I've got some stuff to look up anyway."
"Ah, now then, that's another thing."
Maxwell's round eyes peered from behind his glasses at Cathy.
"It looks as though there'll be some carpenter character in there most of the morning, fitting extra shelving. You're unlikely to get much peace in that room."
"Then," said Cathy firmly, rising to her feet with the Quarter papers, "the only thing I can do is to use Mr. Lendon's office."
"I'm sure the old gentleman won't mind."
The sneering innuendo brought Cathy's head up, but she made no reply. Relatively old Mr. Lendon might be, she thought to herself as she marched out of the room, but he still possesses yards more sex appeal than you do, young Maxwell. She went upstairs to the small room that gloried in the name of a library, where the law reports were kept, and selected a few recent volumes after browsing through the indexes under the section on Higher Purchase. She took them, together with the Quarter papers, to Charles Lendon's room. It was the biggest room in the office, and somehow it was a reflection of the man himself. The walls were painted in a cool, dignified blue, but the Van Gogh reproduction above the fireplace presented a splash of wild, irreverent colour that typified Lendon's own character, for he was a man who, she understood, had let passion overrule prudence on more than one occasion.
The furniture again was a strange contrast. The carpet was thick and wine red, and two stiff-backed chairs stood to attention against the wall, to one side of a new leather armchair. But the second armchair to the left of the fireplace was deep, heavily brocaded, and almost decadent in its flamboyant, sagging-seated luxury. It was Lendon's desk, however, that took her eye on this occasion. Normally it was swept clean and pristine in its appearance, its high-polished surface stark, but for the conventional dignity of a leather-edged blotting pad and a leather-covered pen set. This morning it was cluttered with legal papers. Cathy stared at the desk. She could, she supposed, remove the papers and work on the desk, but she could imagine Lendon's cold anger if he returned to a disturbed surface behind which was seated an insignificant articled clerk. She had not yet felt the keen saber edge of Charles Lendon's anger, but she had witnessed its effects in the outer office. The answer lay in the anteroom. She opened the door. It was a small, stuffy room that lacked ventilation, but the skylight provided enough light, and she could use one of the volumes to prop open the door. The open door would give her enough air, and she could work on the old roll-top desk in the corner, beside the filing cabinet. Quarter. Cathy settled down to the problem. She was soon immersed in it, and she was hardly aware of the passage of time. Lendon's notes of the case were admirable. It would seem that Quarter had complained to the dealer, who refused to remedy the defects or to supply another van. Quarter had then taken his complaint to the hire purchase company, who had loftily said that it was all a matter for Quarter and the dealer to sort out. So he stopped making payments. There was a copy of the letter written by the company solicitor, and the writ was also there. They were claiming damages for breach of the agreement. Interesting. Cathy stuck her pencil between her teeth and ploughed into her books. It must have been about 11:45 when she realized that she needed the volume that was propping open the anteroom door. Without thinking, she crossed the room to pick it up and failed to replace it with another. The door quietly swung shut. Cathy hesitated, then decided not to bother to prop it open again, since she would be finished in 15 to 20 minutes. She scribbled away, giving her opinion about the Quarter case. It was an interesting exercise. It would be useful to read counsel's opinion later, and indeed to discuss it with Charles Lendon for that matter. It was when she had just two further points to make on the sheet that she heard someone enter Charles Lendon's office. Cathy looked up and saw the figure through the frosted glass panel of the door. It was Lendon whom she saw, and he was hanging his coat up on the pegged coat stand in the corner. His dark figure, hazy through the glass, vanished as he went across to his desk. Cathy scribbled on quickly. She could leave this on his desk on her way to lunch. She hoped he wouldn't be too surprised when she appeared out of the anteroom. It was several minutes before she realized that Charles Lendon was not alone. He used a dictating machine on occasion, and at first she had assumed from his level monotone that he was speaking into it. The words were muffled through the door, and she was unable to make out what he was saying. But then she heard a lighter voice, a man's voice, answering Lendon. Again she could make out the words only very indistinctly, but there was something familiar about the voice. It was someone she knew. What she clearly recognized, however, was the anger in the tones. Lendon's voice remained level, but he was like that. Anger was a passion he controlled, but it could be coldly vicious indeed. It was probably more effective for its control. The other voice rose, however, and became almost completely inarticulate at one point. Cathy sat there in the anteroom rigidly. The quarrel in Lendon's office was not communicated to her in any detail, but it was obvious that it was serious in quality, and it was now impossible for her to leave the anteroom and walk through the office. Occasional words drifted through to her as the man arguing with Lendon became more excited. "Can't do this to me.
Lost every damn thing I've got. I've a good mind. Make it all public and the hell with it.
Cathy's face was hot, and she knew that, foolishly, she was blushing. She felt herself to be in an impossible situation. She was not eavesdropping, but she could hear the raised voices and was aware of the anger. She was not deliberately listening, but she could not steal away unobserved. She could only sit there silently and wait. It was too late to leave now. The voices became angrier, and snatches of conversation drifted into her. Father's money sunk into the business. I wish I'd never let you talk me into it in the first place.
Lendon's own measured tone had become a little deeper and more bitterly precise.
Had no option to act otherwise than I did. But for me, you would have been put away for a stretch of years.
The resentment in the other's tone reached a petulant stage, but with the petulance came a slow subsiding also, and even through the closed door, Cathy became aware of the fact that whatever the argument was about, Charles Lendon had the whip hand. She sat still. She did not like her situation. The quarrel in the next room was no longer white in its heat. Lendon's tones were smooth and firm, while the other man was silent. But Cathy could not escape. She could only sit and wait. It was almost 12:30 when the visitor in Charles Lendon's room left. It was 12:40 before Lendon himself went to lunch. Cathy sat on. She had a horror of emerging from the anteroom to be met by Lendon returning, having forgotten something. She couldn't bear to think of the expression that would sweep across his face in such a situation. At 12:50 she gathered her papers together, picked up her reference books, carefully opened the door, and came out into Lendon's office. Outwardly it bore no sign of the quarrel, and yet Cathy felt that the atmosphere remained charged with an indescribable passion. It was fanciful, she knew, and the result of an overwrought imagination, but it was an aura of unpleasantness that she was glad to escape from when she closed the door of Charles Lendon's office behind her. She skipped down the short flight of stairs to the rooms below. She paused outside Parnell's room. Had he heard the quarrel? Indeed, had any of the other staff heard the quarrel? Probably not. The stairs tended to insulate Lendon's room from the others, and words, even white-hot words, would not travel down to other ears. She had probably been the only person in the office to be aware of the quarrel, and even she didn't know who the other participant had been, and yet the voice had been familiar, though roughened by anger. She grimaced at herself in the mirror before she left for lunch. The straight nose wrinkled back at her, the blue eyes narrowed, the curling, unexceptional brown hair glinted in the reflected light. "If I wanted to quarrel," she said to her image, "I wouldn't choose Charles Lendon to cross swords with." But before the afternoon was out, she discovered that there was more than one man in Canthorpe who wanted to cross swords with Charles Lendon. Her principal was late returning that Friday afternoon. When she saw him walk past her room, she called out to him that she had a rough note on the quarter case drafted. "All right, Cathy, I'll have a look at it, but not just yet. If you'll hang on there in your room, I'll come down later and have a word with you about it. Let me have it now anyway, and I'll see you later." She handed the papers to him, and he went upstairs. It was 3:30. At 5:15 she had finished the work outstanding on the Stevenson conveyances, and Charles Lendon had still not put in an appearance. Maxwell came into the room and said cheerily, "Well, I'm off. Not a clock watcher, of course, but it is Friday, after all. Aren't you gone yet?" The other assistant solicitor, Parnell, as tall as Maxwell was rotund, hovered in the background. "Mr. Lendon wants to have a word with me before I leave," Cathy said innocently. "Aha!" The significance in Maxwell's exclamation caused Parnell to snigger. "The old goat has got you staying after hours now, has he? You want us to hang on and preserve your chastity?" Cathy stared at him without expression. The unkind thought that preservation was about all that Maxwell would be capable of came to her, but was not expressed.
Instead, she said, "Someone's calling for me at 5:30 anyway."
"Ah, yes, Mike Ensign, is it? Saw you together last Saturday. Well, he's big and strong enough to..."
"Oh, come on, Max, if we're going to have that beer before we head off."
Parnell pulled Maxwell away, and Cathy rose to get her coat. There was no harm in looking ready to go. Perhaps Lendon wouldn't keep her too long then. He came downstairs only some 30 seconds later. His wicked eye glinted at her as he entered, and he gave her his practiced smile.
"I've got the papers, Cathy. Interesting case, isn't it? Now, let's see."
They stood side by side at her desk. Lendon's shoulder touched hers, but she did not move away. It would be an admission that she was aware of him, and this she was not prepared to do. Somehow Charles Lendon inspired no fear in her, nor did he affect her sexually.
"Quarter, now you say that you think..."
"Ah, yes, that the failure of the company to go into the question of the defects with the dealer, or indeed to sue the dealer if need be, really amounts to a failure on their part to take proper steps to mitigate the loss occasioned by Quarter's refusal to pay further instalments."
He looked at her carefully in consideration.
"Interesting point, that. It would mean that the company couldn't claim damages."
"I think we'd have to be careful in saying that, Cathy.
Nevertheless,
there is a decision along these lines, you know, Mr. Lendon. There's a 1960 case where..."
"You've been doing your homework," Lendon interrupted.
There was something in his voice which made her look at him, and there was something in his eyes also which disturbed her. She could understand neither the tone nor the look. She was not familiar with Charles Lendon's armoury, although she knew enough to recognise danger signals in most men, and she felt confused. She hesitated and returned his glance in puzzlement. There was an odd, admiring expression on his face, and again, while she had seen admiration in other men's eyes when they looked at her, this expression on Charles Lendon's face was new to her. She opened her mouth to speak, to cover her confusion, but unexpectedly other words cut across hers.
"Can I have a word with you, Mr. Lendon?"
The man who stood in the doorway was dressed in a worn grey shirt and a brown corduroy jacket, patched at the elbows and cuffs with leather. His trousers were baggy at the knees, his shoes scuffed and unpolished. He looked like a workman returning home across town, and she knew him. She had seen the heavy, stubble-shadowed face before, pictured in the newspaper and once on television on the local news. A broad, sensible, quiet face that had been lined by anxiety then. The anxiety had, within 24 hours, turned to anguish when the body of his 9-year-old girl had been found in Kenton Wood.
"What do you want, Mr. Carson?" Charles Lendon asked in a level tone. He held himself very erect as he spoke, but with an air of careful truculence.
"I hope it's not going to be a repetition of your earlier request."
"More or less, Mr. Lendon," Carson replied stubbornly. "But I'm not speaking for myself, not now. I'm speaking for others. They've not sent me or asked me to come, but..."
"But you've taken it upon yourself to come."
"That's right."
Carson was unaffected by the sarcasm in Lendon's voice. He stood there in the doorway, a powerful, slightly hunched figure, with his arms dangling by his sides, his fingers loosely curling. He gave an impression of immobility, but Lendon was equally imperturbable. He turned away, presenting his back to Carson.
"Well, I see no point in conversation, since you already know my views."
"I do."
Cathy looked swiftly from one man to the other. Lendon had stiffened and was turning his head slowly to face the man in the doorway.
"You're on my premises, Carson, and we have nothing to say to each other. I suggest you leave now before there's trouble."
"Trouble? Are you going to cause trouble, Lendon, to me, when you've already done all you can to ruin my life?"
Lendon's jaw was hard.
"Don't be a damned fool, Carson. Your daughter, that was nothing to do with me."
"That's what you've said time and again, but it's not how the score lies in my book, and it's why I'm here now.
I don't want to see it happening again to some other poor kid. You...
Lendon's anger was rising, but characteristically he kept his voice on a level tone. It is my sincere hope, as it must be yours, Carson, that there will be no further incidents. But there is nothing I can do.
Incidents?
Carson took a step forward into the room, and there was menace in the set of his shoulders. His voice was quivering with the violence of his anger. He was rapidly losing control of himself in a situation that he must have anticipated, but perhaps it was why he had come.
Incident, you call it? Nothing you can do, you say? You know damned well that if you hadn't closed the right-of-way through Kenton Wood...
There is no right-of-way through Kenton Wood, Lendon said icily.
My daughter would be alive today, and while the right-of-way remains closed, kids will still go through the north path in the woods when they're late or in a hurry.
And one of these days the same thing's going to happen again. Some child is going to end up...
Lendon's eyes glittered angrily.
His scarred eyebrow gave him a satanic appearance. He cut Carson short with a quick gesture.
There's no right of way across my property. Children going to the school across the main road can follow the roads. There is a bus service. There's no need for them to cross my property, and there is even less need for them to go through the north side of the woods. If only parents would accept their responsibilities and ensure that...
Carson's anger broke. Cathy realized that in spite of his apparent calm when he had appeared in the doorway, the man must have been trembling on the edge of violence all the while. Now his obvious hatred for Lendon thrust him over. He blundered forward, reaching out clumsily with a large hand, grabbing for Lendon's shoulder. But the solicitor was twisting away.
"For God's sake!"
Cathy heard herself cry, and then Lendon was pushing Carson past him and stepping aside. Carson's impetus carried him sprawling across Cathy's desk, a big, awkward man. Lendon remained upright, in control, lithely elegant and sneering openly. Cathy came as near to disliking Charles Lendon then as she had ever done. Lendon's voice was cutting.
"I suggest that you make yourself scarce, Carson. You're making a fool of yourself. I could already sue you for assault and battery. Don't make things worse. Stop this hysterical nonsense. Get out of my office."
Carson slowly drew himself upright, one hand on the desk. He glanced toward Cathy. He seemed to have control of his anger again, and his heavy face was apologetic.
"I'm sorry, miss," he mumbled.
But she was even sorrier, and felt like crying, for the look on his face was so much like the expression he had displayed in the newspaper photographs, a puzzled anxiety, a lack of comprehension as to where he had gone wrong. But even as he turned his head towards Lendon, his expression was changing to one of malignity. There was no doubt as to his feelings towards Charles Lendon.
"This isn't the last you'll see or hear of me, Lendon."
"I've no doubt." Carson glared at the solicitor for a long moment and then butted his way past and out into the corridor. Lendon stood staring at the empty doorway in silence, and the angry flush remained on his cheek. At last he flickered a disturbed glance towards Cathy. He was obviously unhappy that she should have witnessed the brawl with Carson. "We'll leave this now," he said, gesturing towards the quarter papers. "We can take the matter up again on Monday." Cathy nodded and put on her coat. Lendon assisted her, his fingers lingering unnecessarily on her shoulder. He made no further reference to Carson. His breathing had slowed again, and he was in full control of himself. He stood aside, and Cathy preceded him to the door. "Can I give you a lift home?" he asked suddenly, and to her surprise a little hesitantly. Hesitancy in Charles Lendon seemed out of character.
"No, thank you, Mr. Lendon. Someone's waiting for me. I hope he is, at least," she said it with a brief smile as she turned away.
Just inside the main doors, Lendon put a hand on her arm.
"Someone waiting. Who is it?"
Cathy was taken aback at the urgency in his tone, for she saw no reason for it.
On the other hand, she saw no reason why he should not know.
A young man called Ensign, Mike Ensign, and in fact there he is now.
Good night, Mr. Lendon. She walked quickly across to the sports car drawn up at the curb on the other side of the road. She got in with a brief apology to Mike for keeping him waiting, but he hardly seemed to hear her. He was looking away from her, glaring back coldly towards the offices of Lendon, Phillips and Barrett. And when Cathy followed his gaze, she saw that Charles Lendon was still standing on the steps of the office. He, in his turn, was staring at the car and at Mike Ensign. Even at this distance, Cathy could see the expression of enmity that shadowed Charles Lendon's features.
Chapter 2. It was a pleasant room, full of dark wood and whorled glass, and dim lights, and it was a room made for lovers. But just loving wasn't enough. These surroundings held memories for Cathy, for Mike had brought her here several times. They had come out of the cold wind, and they had sat in front of the fire, nursing their drinks, and the silences had held them in a warm contentment. Those silences had been loving silences, times to savour what they had come to mean to each other, to think about how it had been and how it would be with each other, to think how it was going to be, together. But tonight it was different, and just loving wasn't enough. The silences that drifted between them were cold anger in an icy sea of disapproval. Cathy had come to believe that such problems could be overcome. The silences and the awkwardness of explanations and the difficulties of a new relationship could usually be smoothed over by the fact of loving, but not always. And that Friday evening, after she had witnessed Lendon's quarrel with Carson, was one of those evenings when a smoothing over was impossible. Cathy glared in silence towards the flaring hearth, while Mike stared moodily at the brass horse buckles, winking fulsomely above the stone fireplace. She snorted and sipped at her lager. She had met Mike Ensign a month ago, when the heavy frosts of late January had turned into a cold February rain. He'd come along a few minutes after a careless driver had drenched her with a great bow wave of puddle water lying above an overflowing drain, and she'd been soaked from head to foot. As she came out of the side road, Mike Ensign, in his sports car, had come squealing to a violent halt, splattering her with thick mud as he did so. Cathy had stood there speechless, shoulders hunched and arms stiffly held out in front of her, glowering at him as he thrust his fair head out of the passenger window. He looked her up and down with a studied casualness that she found infuriating. It was not only his surprised air, it was the fact that water was running down her neck and squelching into her shoes. She clenched her fists impotently and waited. "By God," he had said, "I've seen nothing more like a drowned rat in my life."
"You just splashed me."
"You mean it made any difference?" he had inquired, raising his eyebrows. And she had noticed his friendly slate-grey eyes even through the soaking despondency of her frustration and anger. Then he grinned, and she liked his wide mouth and smile too. "You'd better get in and let me drive you home. In your state you're likely to float there, but this way it'll be quicker." She had hesitated for only a moment. It would have been morally satisfying to snub him, but physically foolish to so indulge her ego. She was damned wet. She got into the car. "I never did like sports cars." The words were by way of salve to her outrage. "You obviously prefer walking in the rain. You must have been out in it for a week." When she extracted the small mirror from her handbag, she could see what he meant. Her dark hair was plastered to her muddy face under the sodden headscarf, and there were dirty stains all over her raincoat. "By God, you don't half smell too," he commented cheerfully. "My name's Mike Ensign, by the way." Fury overrode politeness, and she glowered silently at her mirror. Warm air filtered a little comfort around her squelching feet, but she refused its solace,
and Ensign drove on silently until they reached the outskirts of the town.
"Well," he suggested, cheerful still, "if not names, at least an address. Otherwise, where do I drop you? The nearest pond?"
"I was half drowned by a lunatic roadhog who almost killed me. I do not get wet as a hobby. My name is Cathy Tennant, and I live in a flat in Camden Street.
And I'm delighted to meet you."
He illustrated his delight by calling on her 2 evenings later, and she made little attempt to conceal her own pleasure. It had been a marvellous month in many ways, lifted by the exhilaration of their realizing just what they had come to mean to each other. But it had culminated in something quite unexpected. Mike had asked her to marry him, and she had turned him down. Cathy plonked the glass of lager down on the table to her right and glared defiantly at Mike sitting beside her.
"I didn't really turn you down, you know, not flatly."
"As good as," he disagreed. "No matter, let's just forget it."
"I don't want to forget it. Why are you being so damned pig-headed?"
"Pig-headed? I'm being pig-headed. What the hell is there to describe your conduct?"
"Lower your voice. We're being stared at."
"You call me pig-headed, but as soon as I try to come back at you, you tell me to shut up."
"I didn't say shut up. I said, when all the time it's you who..."
"Was that you were speaking too loudly and..."
"Is being pig-headed in refusing to give me what I regard as an adequate reason for turning me down."
Cathy pursed her lips. Mike folded his arms across his chest and glowered.
"You said you were in love with me."
"That's got nothing to do with it."
"It's got everything to do with it."
"Mike, please." Suddenly she was near to tears, and he saw it, and he put his hand out to her. But this only made things worse, so she grabbed for his handkerchief and blew into it violently. When she looked up, there was the hint of a smile at the corner of his mouth, and his eyes had softened.
"Sometimes I think you're just like a kid," he said quietly.
"Just because I'm only 20 and you're 8 years older." But the earlier rancor had left their voices, and they looked at each other, and she thought that perhaps it would be all right after all. It was a drawback in their relationship, a difficulty that they would have to surmount, this strange barrier that occasionally rose between them. A failure to communicate, a failure to reach each other verbally, that was it. It was a failure that they could bypass, as they were bypassing it now, by the very fact that they were in love, and people in love had their own imaginations and their own conceptual methods of communication. A look, a touch, a breath. This was how it was now. A glance, and things were getting better, even though explanations would yet be necessary. The atmosphere was easier, and communication might again be possible, where it had proved impossible only moments before.
"We've not known each other long, Cathy."
"A month."
"It's happened quickly, this love thing."
"It's happened just right."
"But you won't marry me."
"I won't marry you yet. You didn't let me get out that last word last time. It's a very important word."
"The difference between a positive and a negative, but it doesn't explain anything."
Cathy reached out and took his hand. It was a strong hand that in a way was typical of Mike. He exuded strength, even though he was not heavily built. Strength and reliability. Though there had been occasions when he had seemed almost weak and very vulnerable. But those were private occasions, the thought of which now caused her knees to tremble.
"You've got to understand, Mike. I love you and I hope we will marry, but not yet. It's too early."
"Cathy, I'm 28. I'm a qualified surveyor. I'm earning $2,000 a year. I should soon get a partnership. Hell, I can support a family. Why can't we get married?"
"Because you're qualified and I'm not."
Mike groaned.
"What the hell does that matter?
Look, Cathy, I want a wife, not a breadwinner. It doesn't matter a damn whether you get qualified or not. I want you to bring up my kids, not trouble the Inland Revenue Authorities."
"You're being old-fashioned and you haven't got the point," Cathy insisted stubbornly. I want to qualify, and I'm going to qualify.
All right, why don't we get married, and after I qualify, I'll marry.
Mike's mouth took a grimmer line.
If I'm still around.
If you loved me, you'd still be around.
Mike grunted despondently.
I suppose you're right at that.
She squeezed his hand.
Please try to see my point of view over this matter. Dad keenly wanted me to get a professional qualification if I wasn't going to university, and he's right, because if we married and you died, well, come on, Mike, it could happen, and I was left alone, or with children to bring up, what could I do? If I had nothing behind me but 7 years at school. He's right when he says that getting a professional qualification is important, and that's why he got me the interviews. That's why he arranged for the interview here at the firm, and that's why he'd be against my marrying before I qualified.
You mean it's your father who...
It's my idea, Mike. My idea and my responsibility. In just 18 months I'll have finished my period of articles. Provided I get through the Part 2 exams in this coming summer, I'll become an admitted solicitor. Thereafter, any time you ask me to marry you, I'll do so gladly. But until then, I must refuse. If I marry now, who knows what would happen? Maybe I'd never get to my exams. Maybe I'd lose the incentive to work. I don't know. But I do know what I'm capable of now, and I've got to stick the course.
Mike looked at her calmly, with a twisted half-smile on his face.
You're a stubborn girl, Cathy Tennant. You know your own mind. I can't argue with you.
I'm glad. On this matter, at least, argument will do no good. My mind is made up. It's right for me and for Dad, and, well, for us too in the long run. Apart from that, there's Mr. Lendon.
Lendon? A certain harshness crept into his voice. Where does Lendon come into this?
Cathy looked at him in surprise, raising her eyebrows at his tone.
Well, you know perfectly well that I'm articled to Lendon. He's bound to come into it.
Mike drained his glass of beer before replying. His eyes were slate cold, and they held a vicious gleam.
I see no reason why you need to consider his interests at all.
Mike, I don't think that's fair. Of course I have to consider his interests. He's my principal. He's helped me a great deal. For believe me, there are many principals who give their clerks no help whatsoever.
You mean he's had you ensconced alone with him in his little office when the rest of the staff are gone, don't you?
Don't be so ridiculous, Cathy said, half amused, half exasperated. I tell you he's been very kind and helpful, more than I could expect, I've no doubt.
She paused, and a little of the old anger seeped back as she caught the inflection in Mike's voice and saw the bitter sneer on his face.
And moreover, I have a duty to him under the terms of my employment. I have an agreement with him to work out my articles. He's kept his side of the bargain. I must keep mine. I've got a place in his office. He entrusts me with a great deal of work and a great deal of responsibility. If I were to leave the firm, I would not only be leaving an excellent training ground for myself, but I'd be leaving his office in a certain amount of difficulty. He relies upon me. He's come to look upon me as...
As what, Cathy?
There was no mistaking the implication in his tone, and Cathy's surprise was matched only by her hurt. For some reason, Mike was making something of her relationship with Lendon, making something unpleasant of it, and she knew that he could know nothing that would make such an inference remotely possible.
I think you should explain yourself, Mike.
Why should I go on the defensive? You explain yourself, Cathy.
She released his hand with dignity.
I don't know what you mean by explain. Charles Lendon is my principal. We have a working relationship. He looks upon me as an assistant solicitor rather than as an articled clerk. He treats me professionally and with respect.
He's never treated any woman with respect.
Charles Lendon treats me with professional courtesy and respect. Charles Lendon is about 30 years older than I am.
Hell's bells, Mike groaned. Do you think that makes any difference at all? Don't you know Lendon's reputation? Don't you know that...
Cathy stood up.
There are many things I don't know. There are some things I do not care to know.
She was conscious of heads turning at the bar behind her, but she was angry. It was an anger unlike her previous mood of desperation. This anger was cold and precise.
I've no idea what you're seeking to imply, Mike, and I don't care. I work for Charles Lendon. He's kind to me professionally, and I have no reason to question his conduct in other directions. I want to talk no more about it now. I'd like to go home.
Mike rose to stand beside her. He seemed disturbed. His face was flushed. He fumbled awkwardly with his coat as they moved towards the door, and only Cathy replied to the barman's good night. They walked in silence across to the car, and Mike held the door open for her as she climbed in. When he took the driver's seat beside her, she said nothing. The bonnet of the car sparkled whitely under the moon.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.